So from this session, we begin the power systems. You know the different topics in the power systems. In part one, we deal with transmission and distribution concepts of power system. In part two, we come across the analysis part of the power system. That is, you come across faults, load flows, stability. And in part three, you come across switchgear and protection, where we also further discuss the economics of power systems. So in today's session, we begin with the part one of the syllabus, that is transmission aspects of power systems. Then first topic we come across is, the very first topic is performance of transmission line. So the first topic is performance of a transmission line. So how you determine the performance of a transmission line? We can determine the performance of a transmission line using two parameters. First one is percentage efficiency, second one percentage regulation. So what is the first parameter? It is percentage efficiency. So you consider a transmission line here, sending end power PS, receiving end power PR. So how to write percentage efficiency? Output PR by input PS into 100. So PS how to write? Output PR plus the losses into 100. And how you determine the losses now? For a single phase, we write I square R. In three phase, you write 3 I square R. Then if you write the 3, what about I and R? When you write 3 in a expression, then the corresponding electrical quantities are phase values. When you write root 3 in an expression, corresponding values are line values. So you have written 3 in this expression, so corresponding electrical quantities are phase values. So what is I now? It is the phase current. What is R? R is the per phase resistance. What is R? R is per phase resistance. Now second one is percentage regulation. Now which regulation you calculate? Either speed regulation or voltage regulation. You know transmission line is a static component. For static components we find voltage regulation. For static components we find voltage regulation. So the transmission line is a static or a stationary component, so we find the percentage voltage regulation. You find percentage voltage regulation. So consider the transmission line here, sending end voltage VS, receiving end voltage is VR. Then how you write the percentage regulation? sending end minus receiving end by the receiving end into 100. Suppose you consider a case where you are dealing with no load condition. So under no load condition, current flowing through transmission line, how much? Zero. So what is the voltage drop in the transmission line? Voltage drop in the transmission line is zero. Then what will be the sending end voltage? Same as the receiving end voltage. As you are operating at the no load, indicate receiving end voltage as VR0. Indicate the receiving end voltage as VR0. So how to write the percentage regulation now? VR0 minus VR divided by VR into 100. So regulation is defined as the change in the receiving end voltage from no load to full load, expressed as a percentage of full load receiving end voltage. Change in receiving end voltage from no load to full load, expressed as percentage of full load receiving end voltage. So it is defined as the change in the receiving end voltage from no load to full load, expressed as percentage full load, expressed as percentage full load receiving end voltage. So this is how you define percentage regulation. The change in the receiving end voltage from no load to full load, expressed as a percentage full load receiving end voltage. Now for better performance of a transmission line, we know percentage efficiency must be high and percentage regulation must be low. So for better performance of a transmission line, percentage efficiency must be high and percentage regulation must be low. So these are the two parameters to determine the performance of a transmission line. Now we discuss the classification of transmission line. How the transmission lines are classified? They are classified based on the wavelength. They are classified based on wavelength. So transmission lines are classified based on wavelength. This question is asked in one of the gate question papers. On what basis transmission lines are classified? Whether physical length or wavelength, operating voltage, effect of capacitance. but primary classification is based on wavelength. Because, you know, whenever you say power is transmitted, it is actually the voltage wave that is transmitted and current wave that is transmitted. So power transmission means voltage wave transmission and current wave transmission. Suppose you consider voltage wave traveling like this. Consider the voltage wave traveling like this. And here we have completed one cycle. By this time you have completed one cycle. So how to find out what is the wavelength? You know the formula. Wavelength lambda is the velocity of this voltage wave divided by frequency, divided by the wave frequency here. So consider the voltage wave here. So how to find what is the wavelength? It is velocity by frequency. Velocity writes small v. Now what is the velocity at which voltage wave travels or a current wave travels? It is same as the velocity of light. How much the velocity of light? 3 into 10 power 8 meters per second. And what is frequency? 50 hertz. Or this hertz can be written as what? 50 cycles per second. So how much you get on simplifying? 6000 kilometers per cycle. Now what is the meaning of this 6000 kilometers per cycle? In order to complete one cycle, voltage wave has to travel how much? An angular distance of 6000 kilometers. Has to travel an angular distance of 6000 kilometers. So in order to complete one cycle, voltage wave travels an angular distance of 6000 kilometers. In order to complete one cycle, voltage wave travels an angular distance of how much? Angular distance of 6000 kilometers. Now that is the meaning of this value. 6000 kilometers per cycle. But due to the complexity in power system network, transmission lines are further classified based on the physical length of the line, operating voltage, and effect of capacitance due to complexity in power system network. So due to the complexity in the power system network, transmission lines are classified based on what are the parameters? Physical length of the line, Second, operating voltage. Capacitance effect. So into how many types their transmission lines are classified? They are classified into short, medium, other one is long. What about physical length? 0 to 80 kilometers for short line. So what about this physical length here? 0 to 80 kilometers. What about medium length? 80 to 160 kilometers. Long length greater than 160 kilometers. Now, operating voltage, short line 0 to 20 kV, medium line 20 to 100 kV, long line greater than 100 kV. Then what about the effect of capacitance? Here the capacitance is neglected. Medium line capacitance is lumped. In the long line the capacitance is distributed. Long line capacitance is distributed. So this regarding classification of transmission line based on the physical length, operating voltage, capacitance effect. And now we discuss the analysis of short transmission line. So now first we discuss analysis of short transmission line. Now in the analysis, first we analyze equivalent circuit. So for a transmission line, you represent sending end. How to represent the sending end? Sending end means generating station. Electrically, how to represent a generating station? By an alternator, that is voltage source. So represent Vs, current delivered is Is. Then how about the receiving end? Receiving end, you represent with load. What is the voltage? Vr. How much current flowing? Ir. And in between line, what you will have for this line? R and L connected in series. R, L connected in series. These together, how much you will get? Impedance Z. So these two together you get the impedance Z. Now we develop the mathematical expressions. So how you develop the mathematical expressions? Is equal to IR equal to say I. Then how to write the resistive voltage drop? We write IR. Then how you write the reactive voltage drop? I into what is the reactance JXL. Then you represent the sum, you get total voltage drop. So adding these two, how much? IR plus I, JXL. So I into how much? R plus JXL, I into Z. Now, once you know the total voltage drop, now you can determine what is the sending end voltage VS. How to write this sending end voltage VS? It is like applying KVL to this path here. How much you get VS? VR plus this drop now. So VR plus how much? I into R plus I into JXL. So I into how much? R plus JXL. So you write VR plus I into Z. So after mathematical expressions, we draw the vector diagram. So which vectors you have to draw now? IS, IR, nothing but I. Then VS, VR, resistive drop, reactive drop. We know whenever we draw a vector diagram, we consider a reference vector. So what is the reference vector here? The receiving end voltage VR, in general, you consider as reference vector. So let VR be the reference vector. Then which type of load you consider in general? Most of the loads are RL loads. So here also we analyze RL loads. So we assume RL load. Now for RL load, what is the phase relation? Current lags voltage by some angle phi r, where phi r lies between 0 and 90 degrees. RL load. So what you mention? IR lags VR by phi r. What about that phi r lying between 0 and 90 degrees lag? So the reference is VR here. What about now? IS or IR, both are same as I. This angle is how much now? Phi r. Now we have to complete VS using that equation. So to VR, what you will add? Resistive voltage drop. Draw in parallel to this I. Now draw the reactive voltage drop at 90 degrees. I into JXL. I into JXL. Now what is the resultant of all this now? You get the resultant of all this as VS. Resultant is VS. So you can check here. VR plus resistive drop IR plus reactive drop IJXL is VS. Now angle between IS and VS is phi S. Angle between IS and VS, how much it is? Phi S. Now observe, for RL load, what you got? Phi R less than phi S. So for inductive load, RL phi R is less than phi S. So whenever you deal with inductive load, or you say the lagging power factor load, phi r less than phi s. So when you will get phi r greater than phi s for capacitive load, or you say leading nature load. Capacitive load are leading here. Now next we analyze the short line using ABCD constants. So now you analyze short line using ABCD constants. You know the relations. So what is Vs equal to in general? AVR plus BIR. What about IS? CVR plus DIR. Say the equations 1 and 2. But how much you got Vs in our analysis? Vs you got it as VR plus Z into I. Can be written as 1 into VR plus Z into IR. And how much IS is equal to IR? Can be represented as 0 VR plus 1 into IR. 0 VR plus 1 into IR. So now you compare the equations 1 and 3. A is 1, B is Z. You compare the equations 2 and 4, C is 0 and D is 1. And you can observe A and D are equal, so short line is symmetrical. Further you check AD minus BC, you get 1. So short line is reciprocal. So short line is reciprocal. Now without solving, how to say the short line is symmetrical without solving ABCD constants and without obtaining the values of ABCD constants? How to state short line is symmetrical? Observe the equivalent circuit. You don't have capacitor. If there is no capacitor in an equivalent circuit, then we say the transmission line is symmetrical. If there is no capacitor in the equivalent circuit, then the transmission line is symmetrical. And by default, a transmission line is reciprocal. Any line by default is reciprocal. Now observe few important points which are useful to write the ABCD constants directly by shortcut methods. So three important points. Observe. You have A equal to 1, D is equal to 1. In the equivalent circuit, we have a series branch. Even though you have a shunt branch, A equal to 1 and D equal to 1. So whenever we have a series branch or a shunt branch, please write A equal to 1 and D equal to 1. So what are those three points? A equal to 1, D equal to 1. Either for the series branch or the shunt branch. Secondly, you got B as Z. So you have in the equivalent circuit a series branch. For a series branch, you find impedance. and impedance is given by constant B. Impedance is given by constant B. So whenever we have a series branch, what you will find for that series branch? For the series branch, you find the impedance Z. And that impedance Z is given by the constant B. Now, what about the constant C0? Because constant C determines admittance. And when you find admittance for a shunt branch, in the equivalent circuit, we have only series branch. There is no shunt branch. So you don't find admittance. That admittance given by the constant C is therefore zero. I repeat, in the equivalent circuit, we have only series branch. There is no shunt branch. So you don't find admittance for that shunt branch. So the admittance given by the constant C is therefore zero. So whenever you have a shunt branch, what you will do? You have to find the admittance Y. That is given by what? The constant C. That is given by the constant C. So these three points are important to develop the ABCD constants using shortcut methods. So this is the total analysis of short transmission line. Now we check the analysis of the next one, that is medium transmission line. Next one is the medium transmission line. Now you know that in a medium transmission line, capacitor is lumped. That means concentrated at a point or located at a point in the equivalent circuit. So how many ways are there to represent a medium transmission line? There are four methods to represent a medium transmission line. First one is, suppose you connect a capacitor across the load. You name it as load condenser method. Load condenser method. Suppose you connect a capacitor across the source. You name it as source condenser method. Suppose capacitor is located exactly at the middle. Nominal T method. Suppose capacitor is equally splitted into two parts across source and load. We name it as nominal pi method. We name it as nominal pi method. So there are four methods to represent a medium transmission line. Based on the location of capacitance in the equivalent circuit. Based on the location of capacitance in the equivalent circuit. So now we read the next heading, analysis of medium transmission line. And what is the first method you deal now? Load condenser method. First method is the load condenser method. So where the capacitor is connected across the load. So a current flowing through capacitor is IC, voltage across capacitor is VC. Voltage across capacitor is VC. Now, what are the mathematical expressions? IS equal to IR plus IC. Voltage drops are due to which current? IS. Resistive voltage drop, IS into R. Reactive voltage drop, IS into JXL. What about sending end voltage? It is VR plus, applying KVL to this path. So what you will get? VR plus IS into R, IS into JXL. So this is how you represent the sending end voltage VS by applying KVL to this path. How much VS is? Here VR plus IS into R plus IS into JXL. You represent sending end voltage VS. Now we complete the vector diagram. Consider VR as the reference vector. Assume RL load. IR lags VR by phi R, and phi R lies between 0 and 90 degrees. Now here, capacitor and load are in parallel, so you can also mention VC as VR. So when you draw the reference as VR, it is also nothing but VC. Assume RL load, so IR lags VR by how much? This angle is phi R. IR lags VR by how much? An angle phi R. Now what about IC now? You want resistive drops due to IS. How to write IS? IR plus IC. So first to develop IC. IC is current flowing through capacitor. For capacitor, what is the phase relation? Current leads voltage by 90 degrees. So what about IC now? IC leads VC by 90. So VC is here. So I represent IC leading VC by 90. Now add this IC to the tip of IR. Add this IC to the tip of IR. So how much now? IR plus IC. IR plus IC is IS. IR plus IC is IS. Now include the resistive drop due to IS. Then reactive drop due to IS. Sum of all this, VR plus resistive drop due to IS, reactive drop due to IS. Adding all this, what you will get? The sending end voltage VS. Add all this here, you get the sending end voltage VS. And between IS and VS, indicate the angle as phi S. So between IS and VS, the angle is phi S. So this is how you draw the vector diagram for load condenser method. So I repeat the steps here. First to represent IR, VR. VR is the reference vector. drawn along the positive x-axis. IR lags VR by how much? By an angle phi R. IR lags VR by how much? By an angle phi R. IC leads VC by 90. Now add IC to the tip of the vector IR. So IR plus IC is IS. Now include the resistive drop due to IS, reactive drop due to IS. Sum of all these three, what you get now? VS. So this is how you develop the vectors diagram. Now we have to check the ABCD constants. Observe in the equivalent circuit, we have a series branch and then shunt branch. So we have to multiply two matrices. One is the series branch and other one is a shunt branch. Either for series branch or shunt branch, A equal to 1 or D equal to 1. For series branch, you find impedance. Impedance is given by the constant B. So B is Z, C 0. Now for shunt branch, you find admittance. The admittance is given by constant C and B is 0. So I repeat how you enter the values. Either for series branch or shunt branch, A equal to 1 or D equal to 1. For series branch you find impedance, so B is Z. For series branch, we don't find admittance. So the admittance given by the constant C is 0 for series branch. For shunt branch, A equal to 1 or D equal to 1. For shunt branch, you find admittance. Admittance given by the constant C. So C is Y. For shunt branch, you don't find impedance. So the impedance given by the constant B is 0. This is the shortcut method to develop the ABCD constants. So on multiplying this one, you get 1 plus YZ, Z, Y and 1. Now you check A and D, are they equal? Not equal. So what about this load condenser method is unsymmetrical. What about AD minus BC? You check it as 1. So what about the load condenser method? Is reciprocal. Load condenser method is reciprocal. So this is how you analyze the ABCD constant. Now, without obtaining the values of ABCD constants, how to say that load condenser method is unsymmetrical? Because we are having capacitor in the equivalent circuit. Is the capacitor located symmetrically in the equivalent circuit? It's not located symmetrically in the equivalent circuit. It is connected only across the load. It is located unsymmetrically in the equivalent circuit. Therefore, without solving, we can directly say that load condenser method is unsymmetrical because capacitor is located unsymmetrically in the equivalent circuit. So load condenser method is unsymmetrical. So you can mention as capacitor is located unsymmetrically in the equivalent circuit, so load condenser method is unsymmetrical. The same way we find by shortcut method, the ABCD constants we find by the shortcut method for all the remaining methods further. Okay, now we have 5 minutes break. Now, first question is by Anirban from Durgapur. Why transmission line voltages are in the factor of 11? The reason is an insulator is designed to withstand an operating voltage of 11 kV. Also, nowadays 400, 500 kV lines are there. But due to the high voltage transmission being economical, we are not only having multiples of 11, we have 400, 500 kV, 750 kV also further. But 11 kV, 22 kV, 132 kV, they are designed based on insulators. You know, each insulator can withstand an operating voltage of 11 kV. Next question is by Arijit from Kolkata. Please discuss power supply systems and why power frequency is double. No, in further classes, I cover through those power supply systems. But your question is, why power frequency is double further? You know this formula, power, how you write? Voltage into current, Vm sin omega t, Im sin omega t. If you simplify this one, how much you get? Vm Im by 2 minus Vm Im by 2 cos 2 omega t. So supply omega t, power how much? 2 omega t. So you say power frequency is 2 times the supply frequency. Next question is by Rachel. For regulation, we find only voltage regulation. There is no other parameter to find voltage regulation. Now, transmission line is a static component. For static components, we find voltage regulation. Next question is by Somdev from Berhampur. Which book is suitable for power systems for practice? For practice, at this stage, you please refer all the previous gate question papers, all the previous IAS question papers. Next question is by Arijit from Kolkata. How to draw single phase equivalent circuit of a three phase star delta transformer? See, when I come across the sequence networks and I can draw accordingly for your questions. And what is reactive power? Reactive power is due to the reactive elements, that is inductor and capacitor. What is its significance? We again discuss while doing the voltage control methods, please. Next question is by Vishaka Singh from UP. What is the significance of using RL load? Now, using RL load, always VR is less than VS. Due to capacitive loads, we discuss further in next hour or two, you get VR greater than VS. And most of the loads are RL loads. Next question is by Arijit from Kolkata. Without capacitance in the equivalent circuit, why transmission line is symmetrical? No, it is a shortcut method to say the answer. So no proof for that. Whenever equivalent circuit do not have capacitance, then the equivalent circuit is by default symmetrical. Next question is by Nidhi from Kanpur. Are these shortcut methods valid when we have a combination of both series and shunt? See, let there be any combination of series or shunt or both, our shortcut methods are valid. Anyway, you can analyze For every method,
Hello.
use the shortcut
How should
methods
I
only.
be? Hello.
Hello, yes.
Hello.
Hello, please ask your questions.
Hello.
Hello, please ask your
Hello.
question, please.
May I ask my question?
Yeah, please continue. Please.
Okay, so I have to ask that in some books it is written that transmission lines also behave as a whole like a capacitor, means they give the property of capacitor. So how we can justify that our transmission line can give the property of a capacitor?
No, transmission line behaves like a capacitor only during the compensation techniques, please. So you know there are five compensation devices: shunt capacitor, series capacitor, shunt inductor, synchronous capacitor, synchronous inductor. So during those shunt elements connected at the receiving end of the line, then we can support your statement. So anyway, we come across in deep with analysis when you do the topic voltage control methods, where we discuss each of these devices in detail, please.
Okay, sir, one more question I have to ask.
Yeah, please.
In this load condenser method, you have written that IR less VR by phi R. So how we can define the that degree range that from 0 degree to 90 degree it will vary phi R?
No, we are having IR here. It is current flowing through the RL load. Across the RL
Yes.
load, voltage is VR. You know, for RL combination, what is the phase relation? Current lags voltage by an angle phi R, where phi R lies between 0 and 90 degrees, please. You have a series RL
Okay.
circuit. So what is the phase relation? I lags V by angle phi, where phi lies between 0 and 90 degrees.
Okay, sir. So means we have used the basic property here that.
Yeah, basic properties, what you come across in the
Okay. Okay.
networks.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Right. Thank you. The next question is by Vishaka Singh from UP. In ABCD constants of short line, please explain why this ABCD, what this ABCD basically defines, and how they are related to shunt or series of the network circuit. Now, definitions we come across mostly at the end of today's session, but as of now, you come across these points. A equal to 1 and D equal to 1 either for a series branch or shunt branch. And for series branch, you find impedance Z. That impedance Z is given by constant B. For shunt branch, you find admittance Y. That admittance Y is given by the constant C. So these three points are important. Next question is by Arijit from Kolkata. Why there is no series capacitance, always shunt capacitance in transmission lines? No, we have both connected, please. Series capacitor to improve the power system stability, shunt capacitor to improve the voltage at the receiving end of the line. Okay, we come across this in the further topics where we discuss in depth further. Next question is by Abhishek. What do you mean by line as reciprocal? Same property of reciprocal which you come across in the two-port networks. Voltage by current at the sending end is equal to voltage by current at the receiving end. Next question is by Rachel. Why we call it nominal pi or nominal t? Because the term nominal indicates that we are operating at rated voltage. The meaning of the term nominal is the system is operating at rated voltage.